Good afternoon, this is Felix, and I'll take you through the clinical presentation, complication, investigation, and diagnosis. So, on clinical presentation, usually the presentation is based on the causative agent, the local underlying cardiac disease, the pathology, and the involvement of other organs. So as we all know, the first thing that we should do, you must take a thorough history so as to identify the risk factors, as have been explained by Dr. Lucy. And then we usually have two phases of the infective endocarditis. There is an acute and acute phase. And usually the main complaint is fever. So in subacute, the patient can have fever and present with non-specific symptoms. So when you take your history, any patient with a risk factor, one of the risk factors, any fever with non-specific symptoms and signs should raise a high suspicion of infective endocarditis. And in subacute, the symptoms usually takes weeks to months, and the patient can have those symptoms for quite some time and can present with the symptoms as I've shown here. They can have muscle pain, joint pain, chest and abdominal pain, dyspnea. They can have weight loss and other central nervous system manifestations. So when the patient gets into an acute, usually that is the severely progressive disease. They usually have high spiking fever and other signs and symptoms depending on the organ involved and the pathological, like the gonadal phenomenon, immunological response, and so on and so forth, and then metastatic infection. And in subacute, the main causative agent is mainly the viral streptococcus, enterococcus, and coagulase negative, while in acute, it's mainly due to staph aureus. So, as I've said earlier, complication of infective endocarditis can be multi-systemic. The patient can present with one or more complications involving cardiac, neurological, renal, pulmonary, musculoskeletal, metastatic, and immunomediated. So this is a summary of the complications that the patient can have. In neurological, 35% of patients who have symptomatic infective endocarditis can present with cerebrovascular complications. And the presentation can be embolic stroke, brain abscess, or cerebritis, as we have seen. And so if you have a patient who has neurological deficit, stroke, and fever, and either one of the risk factors, that should give you a high suspicion of infective endocarditis. And then on cardiac, the patient can have features of heart failure. On renal, they can present with renal failure. This due to immune-mediated glomerulonephritis due to ongoing deposition of immunoglobulin in the glomerular membrane, and so it causes the damage of glomerular. And they can also have pulmonary presentation. They can present with pulmonary pneumonia, lung abscess, pleural effusion, as well as pneumothorax. And they can have musculoskeletal presentation. They can have osteomyelitis and arthritis. So when you take your thorough history, the patient may present with back pain that is worsening with time, as well as joint pain. So this can be the only presentation at times. So you just need to evaluate your patient thoroughly and think about infective endocarditis. So there are other metastatic embolization. You can have a stroke, as I've mentioned earlier, and infarct in one of the major blood vessels. So on investigations, We have specific investigation that has to be done, that is blood culture as well as echocardiogram. And for blood culture, it advised that you should take 3 to 5 blood cultures, and you have to follow the standard aseptic technique so that you don't get the false negative blood culture. And usually, it says that about 90% the microorganisms or the causative agents are usually isolated from the first 2 blood cultures. So, and another investigation is an echocardiogram that if you do the echo, you see the vegetation, the features of gallbladder insufficient, like regurgitation and obstruction. And also you have to do other non-specific investigations like ESR and CRP, the CBC, the urinal analysis, the rheumatoid factor, and other like renal function tests. So because the patient they usually present with fever, that's why we are investigating thoroughly so as to be able to get the now these were the investigation on diagnosis. Now to diagnose infective endocarditis, we use the Dukes criteria, and there is, I think this was the previous one, we have modified Dukes criteria where you have to prioritize the patient into 3 groups: the definitive infective endocarditis, possible infective endocarditis, and rejected infective endocarditis. For definitive, the main criteria are pathological as well as the clinical criteria. Where in pathological, there is microorganism as well as pathological lesion, and you must have you must have 2 major criteria, that is the blood cultures and echocardiogram, and 1 major criteria, 3 minor criteria, and 5 criteria to get a definitive clinical diagnosis. For possible, so for definitive, it's pathological criteria and clinical criteria. While for possible infective endocarditis, we use the clinical criteria, where you see 1 major criteria and 1 minor criteria gives you the possible infective endocarditis. For rejected infective endocarditis, the patient does not qualify for possible or definitive endocarditis, and usually the symptoms resolve after a few days. So that was